going on, everybody? Here we are, Collider Heroes, episode 33. I'm Jon Schnepp. Welcome to another episode. This week, we've got, as always, John Campea joining us.
If I mention today, it is November 17th. We are exactly 1 month away from Star Wars The Force Awakens.
That's right.
I just got to say that on every single show I do today.
That's right.
It's a good day. I'm getting excited.
Yeah. And we just keep hearing awesomer and awesomer
yes,
news.
Yes, we do.
Speaking of news, we've got a great guest star today. Her name is Amy Dallen. And you can find her on Geek and Sundry's The Pull. Welcome
yes.
to our show.
Thank you so much for having me. You also can usually find me when you come in to buy comic books from me at the comic book store I work at, House of Secrets in Burbank.
That's right. That's one of my two places that I constantly go to is Meltdown and House of Secrets. Those are the places I go to get my comics. So check it out the next time you're in Hollywood or Los Angeles. Starting off, we're going to rock right into it. Number one story, we've got Lea Seydoux is definitely going to be playing Belladonna, and Doug Limon is going to be directing Gambit. So this has all been confirmed. The actress accepted the role of Gambit's main lady, Belladonna Boudreaux. I think that's how you
Boudreaux.
Say it.
Boudreaux.
Yeah, Boudreaux.
It's comics. None of us have heard it.
I know. How do you really say
if
it?
Anything I've learned in life is if you want to know how to say something in the proper French pronunciation, listen to Schnepp.
That's right.
Anything.
It's definitely one of my
like
talents.
Gospel.
I know. So like I said, Belladonna Boudreaux has been cast. Lea Seydoux. is playing it. And then we've also got the director, Doug Limon, who did a great job with Tom Cruise last year's All You Need Is Kill, Edge of Tomorrow, Live, Die, Repeat, the movie that has like 15 titles. But he did a great job as a director. He's going to be directing Gambit now. So.
I didn't see this coming, and it's so exciting.
Yeah.
Oh, my god.
What are your thoughts on it? What do you think?
Well, just, I like this. It's weird that a Gambit movie is happening on a certain level. Like, I'm a 90s X kid, so I get it. But I don't, like, it's still bizarre that he should be the next, like, solo, but whatever. You have the star, you have everything in place. More X-Men films will always make me happy. When we lost the director, I thought that was a huge problem for this mm-hmm. whole project. But I have loved a number of Doug Liman's films, and now I'm kind of really excited again.
Yeah, it's exciting news. How about you, John?
This might actually be one of those situations where you lose a director that you were really looking forward to directing a film, and then another guy comes in, you're thinking, he might be even a better fit. Like, when you think about the action stylings of, like, a Mr. and Mrs. Smith, which I think is really an underappreciated movie. That
it's
movie
so much
is
better than it should be.
It really is. That is true. The best way to describe it. Better than it should be. And then you have Edge of Tomorrow, and I just got to say, I have worked with Doug Limon before. He has directed me in, of course, his best film, Jumper, which I had the pleasure of being in a couple of scenes in that movie as an extra. But no, and seriously, he's a funny dude on set. I was only on set for like 8 hours, like for one day. But he's funny. He's very loose. But when you look at those other movies he does, he has action sensibilities. But then you see, like, Edge of Tomorrow, he knows how to mix the dramatic elements with those action sensibilities. You bring something like that now to something like Gambit, add in a little bit of fun, like a little bit of Bourne to it as well. I mean, this could be a really good fit. And clearly, Channing Tatum is very big on this guy. So I think this is good. If you're somebody who's looking forward to the Gambit movie, I know there's some people who aren't. But if you are, this is a good day. This is really good news.
Yeah, and he's also a good actor's director. You know,
really
like all
is,
the different
yeah.
actors he's worked with, you get really good performances from them. Once they announced that the movie was jumping into the $150 million range, is
I'm
when I started
to.
Yeah, I was like, come on, it's Gambit New Orleans. What universe are you,
you
building?
You can do Deadpool for like 40.
I know.
Like, why can't you do Gambit for less than 150?
He's throwing explosive cards. Where's all those
very expensive cards?
The blowing up. It's just going to take so much CG.
There's no CG. No, there is no CG. Yeah. They're actually developing exploding cars.
They're blowing up buildings and they're all real. So I don't know. I mean, I want to see where that money's going. But I also heard they're going to push the movie. It's pushed a year now. So it's not coming out in 2016. It's going to be coming out in 2017. So that's the only bummer
news. I think a lot of us were expecting after the director dropped out. They were falling behind. There was no way they were going to have this ready in time.
Right. So next year we don't get 7 superhero movies. We only get 6.
How will we live?
I know. I don't know what's going to happen anymore. I'm depressed. It's pretty insane. So they're going to push it a year. That's cool. As long as it's a good movie.
Here's a funny thought, though. Like, do you know that right now we are probably now at the we are facing the longest dry period right now with no comic book movies that we will ever have again, probably for the next 6, 7, or 8 years. Like, think about it. We are never again, in the next 5, 6, 7, 8 years, we are never going to go 6 months without a comic book movie. It's just not going to happen.
Are we
we're
really
never
going 6 months away from the next one?
No, not at this point, but we're in that. So from when Ant-Man came out to when
Deadpool comes out.
It was probably 5 or 6 months. Yeah. For the next 5, 6, 7 years, we're never going to have that long of a dry spell.
Every 2 to 3 months, a giant mega movie drops. Every 2 to 3 months.
Isn't that crazy?
Yeah, like 100+ mega movie is going to be coming out. That's pretty crazy because right now we're like, I can wait because we've got Star Wars coming out next. It's not like it's so many months to wait. It's like these other giant movies. The
Hunger
Revenant.
Hunger Games is opening this week. Revenant, the new Quentin Tarantino film, Hateful Eight. There's a lot of big
Let alone
projects.
Like 6,000 superhero TV shows that I have to catch up on that I don't have enough time in my life to even watch. People are like, you got to watch The Flash. I'm like, I'm trying to just catch up on some other
shows. We decided to do about Daredevil.
Yes. Actually, that would be really, we should actually think about, you know, we all know that Jessica Jones is dropping this coming
Jessica
week.
Jessica Jones!
So we've been talking about, obviously we're going to watch all of them, and this time I'm watching all of them, because I still haven't finished watching Daredevil. I still have to watch the last.
I swear to freaking God, for like 3 months, he's been on, I've only got 5 more episodes to go. And then, like, 3 weeks later, it's just got 5 more episodes to go.
I know, because I'm like, I get home, I'm like, I got to watch Walking Dead. I can't not watch it. So I have, like, the one episode that I have to keep up with. And then these other, that's, like, 5 hours.
Because
like,
you fall behind on Walking Dead. Yeah. It's getting spoiled for you.
I know,
you,
and it's already happened to me multiple times. Like, people, did you know about this? Not until you told me. Thanks.
But tell people what we're going to do with Jessica Jones and Daredevil.
Yeah, so we're talking about doing a Jessica Jones, like, we're not going to do one for every episode, but we're going to do, like, a nice, tasty, like 90-minute, whatever. We're going to talk about the entire series. But then we were talking about Rock and Daredevil first because we haven't done that yet. So stay tuned. We'll announce when we're going to do it.
2018, when Jon Schnepp finally finishes watching Daredevil, right just before Justice League Part 1, you can watch our Daredevil review.
I swear to you and all the people watching this now that I will finish the Daredevil series this weekend.
Don't do it for us. Do it for you.
No, it's for you.
I'm just doing it publicly for myself. So I will finish watching it because I want to. I will carve out the time.
So yay, Doug Limon.
Yes, Doug Limon is awesome. Let's move on to another world, the world of Thor, Asgard, and Ragnarok. We have got, is Valhalla and the Queen of the Dead, Hela, going to be part of Thor Ragnarok? So we've heard Hela. These rumors. Yeah, Valkyrie and a whole bunch of other Valkyries are going to be involved in the third Thor movie, as well as possibly the Enchantress and the Executioner. I've heard those names being rumbled around. Of course, we got Hulk showing up in some weird world that's not Midgard, it's not Asgard. Now comes news that I've just this rumor right now that maybe Kate Blanchett is talking about. No, you're shaking your head. No,
shut up.
I know. No, if it happens, that would be incredible.
Can you imagine that?
Hela.
The full Jack Kirby, crazy
with the big
hat
headdress.
Cave kind of. Oh.
The only thing that would make that news even better, is if Kenneth Branagh was coming back to direct it, because he just directed Cate Blanchett in that Cinderella movie.
Oh, right.
And I think she deserves an Academy Award nomination for that. I mean, and I love what Branagh did before. Look, you've reached a point now with the Thor movies and with the Marvel Cinematic Universe in general. All bets are off.
Yeah.
You can do, like, when they're first getting started with the Marvel Cinematic Universe, right? It's like, let's keep it a bit grounded. The Iron Man suit, how we develop this and visit Captain America. You know, there was the fantastic, but it was within the mundane. They kept it pretty simple. But now we're at a point after Ultron, and now we got Doctor Strange. It's all bets off. They can really do anything now. Like, absolutely anything.
Yeah.
So the Valkyrie, the Enchantress, all that kind of stuff, maybe things you couldn't have done 3 years ago in the Marvel Cinematic Universe. But now, it totally fits. Totally makes sense. We wouldn't even bat an eye at it.
I want to see all that weird, crazy Kirby designs. Amy, what do you think about Hela?
I think I'd be very happy to see her. She's an awesome character who usually plays the role of a villain, but she isn't exactly. She's just ruling the dead in the, like, not for honored people section of the ruling the dead. And I think that would be fantastic. I don't know whether it makes me crazy. I don't want to get too attached to anything that may not happen.
Right.
Like, Enchantress would be great.
Welcome to our world.
Would be great.
Right.
But, that would be so much fun.
Doesn't she fit into the word Ragnarok perfectly a villainess? Like, I want to bring me those dead that don't deserve to be alive. I'll take them. So she could be, like, teaming up with someone else who's
you know, their goal is like, I want everything to end.
And canonically, she's the daughter of a version of Loki. Mm-hmm. So there's some team up and or falling out possibilities there.
It's right with that. You could
get into right connections now. Here. Now, this might be stretching it for the film version, like mm-hmm. when you compare it to comics, but there are possibilities of drawing connections now between, I mean, who does Thanos worship? Right?
Death.
And this, so you could start to see in Ragnarok them stretching that a bit and start to make those connections, because they gave us death right from that first post-credits scene of the first Avengers movie. Right. To battle them is to court death, and yay, big smiles. I mean, that could be it could be the door opening here.
That Hela could hold one of those Infinity Gems. She might. I mean, you know, Doctor Strange, there's two of these gems left. One of them's going to be the weird trans-dimensional one, and the other could be from death itself. You know, who knows? You know, it could, they can, you know, I can't even speak. It could be insane.
People will, of course, be noting right now that, like, Hela is not traditionally the version of death in the comics that he's in love with.
Right.
But, like, there's no reason you couldn't maybe, like, that's a change I'd be open
to. You'd have to play with it a bit.
Yeah, then, yeah, I mean, it's sort of a fun way that the Marvel Cinematic Universe has been able to fold in all of the different decades of comic books.
Yeah.
So we were able to, with Avengers, we were able to enjoy the Ultimates as well as the original very first Avengers with Hulk and all these other characters in it. The Ultimates was just a retelling of the very first Avengers. So it was great. It just didn't have Freddie Prinze Jr. in it, which, remember, Bruce Hulk was like, bring me the head of Freddie Prinze Jr. They should have had him having dinner, like, hiding or something.
Well, you know, we could talk to Freddie about that.
I know, that's right.
He does come in here.
You know, he is
a
pal of Collider Video, guys, so maybe that can happen eventually. Let's move on to the next topic. We got Ant-Man and the Wasp, some original flavor. They're talking about Michael Douglas. He wants to get back into the microverse of Ant-Man sequel. He's just asking for less expositional scenes, is how he put it, and I'm all for that. We'll see more sequences of the original Ant-Man and the original Wasp. Will we see that? Like, I'm a big fan of show us, don't tell us. I hate the exposition alley when people are like, well, let me tell you a tale, and then you're just on some dude's face telling the tale. I'm like, show me the tale. So I think that's what Michael Douglas is saying. Look, man, I'm ready to rock those 60s scenes of espionage as the original Ant-Man. Let's do it. We saw a deleted scene of the Ant-Man Blu-ray mentioning the Ten Rings. The Yellow Jacket villain basically was kind of mentioning that. So let's talk about Michael Douglas first. What do you guys think about seeing, like, we had actually talked about that. Remember when it was first announced as Ant-Man and the Wasp? We mentioned in a Collider Movie Talk, we're like, what if we get more flavor from the original Ant-Man and the Wasp?
As
it's like double. Yeah.
I'm desperately hungry for that. That was sorry to jump in, but the overwhelming thing that was an issue for me enjoying Ant-Man this summer, which was an incredibly enjoyable movie. The one thing that just stuck in my craw the entire time was how much it didn't serve Janet.
Right.
And then Hope, and that it was actually a plot point that Hope didn't get to do anything. And it was like, I'm kind of giving you this, but you're hurting me. And so it felt like them following that up with the announcement of Ant-Man and the Wasp, it was like, all right, now you're going to do it. And so this is their chance to, A, just tell a story and make it good. That's obviously the first priority. But also, I would really love for them to go back and serve Janet better. And, like, it started to feel cruel during Ant-Man that they would hide her face in every photo. And I realized there are practical reasons for that, because they didn't have an actress playing Janet.
Right.
And you don't want to blow some big announcement on someone who doesn't get to do anything. But the great news is, as understandable as all those decisions were, now you get to do it.
Yeah.
That's exciting. That's incredibly exciting.
And it's a double Wasp. You got Janet and you got Hope. You got the reveal of, oh, this was the Wasp's original outfit. And you know that in Civil War, there's going to be some Wasp action happening. Like Hope, you know, playing the Wasp. But now we're like, who's going to play Janet in those flashbacks? Is she stuck in Doctor Strange's transdimensional world? Because we've seen those still shots where you're like, that is a Wasp-looking character in that bizarre, weird trip scene. What do you think?
I think they're going to get Catherine Zeta-Jones to come back and play Janet. No, I'm just kidding.
That would be crazy. Sorry.
But you know what's funny, though, is that, you know, Michael Douglas talked about maybe a little the exposition, but one of the things I thought Ant-Man did really well, because you're right, every once in a while, we get it. A movie does need a scene where you just close in on the guy's face telling the exposition.
Right.
Every once in a while, that's needed. I get it. But you prefer being shown. What I thought Ant-Man did a pretty good job of was mixing that, because what they would do is Michael Douglas would start to talk about what happened to Hope's mother. Mm-hmm. And then what does it do? It cuts to the scene of them on the missile.
Totally.
So it kind of did a nice blending of that. I'd like to see them continue. But you're right. That's what jumped out at me when they first showed us that family portrait with Michael and his wife. But the wife had the veil right down. Not the veil, but the rim of the hat. It's like, they're keeping their options open, because they don't know who's going to play this character yet. I would love love, love, love to see a movie. Now, we know this movie is going to focus on Paul Rudd and Hope, but
which it should, but
you could do a really good Godfather Part Two sort of thing, where you tell your story and you jump back and forth between the timelines, showing what happened then, what happens now. And look, I sat down and talked to Michael Douglas about this a couple of times, and he was unapologetic about it. Like, this was his first comic book movie, and he was like, "I want to come back and play Pym again." That's what he told me. He said, "I want to come back and play Pym again." And I had the feeling he wants to do a little bit more than just be the good brains of the operation sitting in his little, you know, workshop. Yeah. And I hope we get to see him do a little bit more.
Well, with technology, the way they shot him, they just did those little dots and did a smoothing CG mask on him, and it worked perfectly. I would love to see him back and forth in time. I'd volley for, like, please give me a 5-minute flashback sequence to open Ant-Man and the Wasp.
Yeah, and that would be dope. Just give me that Ant-Man mask for four of those minutes, and you're totally good.
It would be fantastic. I mean, it's so weird to live in a world where we're talking about an Ant-Man sequel.
Yes.
I mean,
cool, it's like, the Ant-Man's in it.
I've told people before, when I was in college, I wrote an Ant-Man comic book with a friend of mine who passed away, who drew the Ant-Man comic, and we were both really into, like, all the superheroes, and we were, like, coming up with all this crazy stuff. And to see a character that's, like, such a side character, a little small character, literally a small character like Ant-Man, get a giant movie, and it's done so well, and it was so much fun and flavor and honor to the original series. Paul Rudd, all those guys, hats off to all of them for really making all of our dreams come true as, like, little kids that we grew up with reading these comic books. We're getting to see them done on a spectacular level. So I can't really get behind anyone who's like, there's too many superhero movies. There's not even enough yet. We'll tell you when we're tired of them. So let's move on. We got Flash and the Arrow are adding some legends. This two-parter called Legends of Today and Legends of Tomorrow, it's going to introduce all the brand new team members. You got the Atom, you got Rip Hunter, you got Hawkman, Hawkgirl. Who else do we have? We got Captain Cold. Who's the Heat guy? What, I always forget his name.
Oh, I forget it, but it's Wentworth Miller's brother from Breakout. I can't remember.
Captain Heaty. No, I don't know what his name is. You got Captain Cold, and what's the...
I'm actually not caught up on Arrow. Is this one of the already introduced ones? Is it Firestorm, or is it somebody else?
No, this is on the Flash side.
But Firestorm is also in it. Thanks for mentioning him. He's definitely in it as well. It's the other guy. I can't remember what his name is. It's Captain Cold and the guy who's got the I heat things up.
Yeah, he's so, got a fire gun
disclosure,
of some sort.
Full disclosure, I have finally heat started wave. Watching the CW shows, but I'm only right on the end of season one of Arrow.
Yeah, no, I'm unfortunately even farther behind. I was able to watch the first 5 episodes of Flash and loved it. But I'm like, a season behind right now.
Yeah, it's because I've heard so many good things specifically about The Flash that I was like, I'm missing out. I gotta do this.
But. And The Flash is actually kind of forcing me to go back to watch Arrow. Because all these people who love The Flash, like, dude, if you liked Flash, you're actually going to really like Arrow 2. I was like, nah, I know, but that's...
Especially season 2. Yeah. Arrow season 2 is really... It kind of jumps the shark a bit in season 3, but Arrow season 2 is a really fun season of television.
What about season 4? Because now that's tying more in with The Flash.
I haven't been on board. I mean, I know, like, Anne, she hosts the Arrow recap
John
show
Campea's
here
wife,
on
Anne.
Collider Video. And I know she's been digging season 4 a lot. So, I mean, I'm really more tuned into Flash. Like, that to me is just... I mean, all due respect to... I love Daredevil. Gotham is vastly improved over season 1, because season 1 was just a joke, but season 2 is a lot better. But all due respect to all that, Flash is the best comic book series on TV right now. I'm telling you, I'm loving that show. I'm really eating it up.
So. I am going to eat up all of Flash during Thanksgiving. I think I might make a special Flash day for myself. You know, just give
it's a good
for
day.
Myself. It's not for you guys. It's for me. I'm going to watch The Flash and just catch up so I can feel like I'm part of everybody's conversation, because we're on here and people are talking about, I know who they're talking about because I'm a comics nerd. They're like, Grodd was in. I was like, what do you mean Grodd? Like, what?
Dude,
that's
what's going
on? Every week at the comic book store since these shows came out, like, I'm watching through season 1 and I'm just like, I remember when people freaked out about this. I remember when people freaked out about that. It's kind of neat. Like, I'm going back through these milestones. But yeah, speaking of conversations we never thought we'd be having, Rip Hunter's coming to television.
I know, that's crazy. Yeah, I mean, that's real to me, Hawkman, Hawkgirl. I mean, you have the Atom, but the way they're doing the Atom, and once again, I have to catch up, but, like, from what I've watched, they're doing the Atom is kind of like a Iron Man, but kind of goofy, like the greatest American hero / Iron Man, where he's like, oh, of course,
you know
like,
who's playing him.
Yeah, it's Superman himself, Brandon Ralph.
Brandon Ralph is playing him.
And he's doing a great job.
He really
has that
is,
really
yeah.
fun, just from the scenes I've seen, has this really fun way of, like, you know, making kind of being a bumbling, like, more bumbling than Clark Kent.
I mean, he's a genius in the show. He's like, he's a hyper genius, but socially awkward, a little golly gee, you know, sort of thing. And he creates this thing. In the show, he's a widower. He watched his wife murdered by street criminals.
Wow.
And so he makes a decision that he's never going to let, as far as his power will allow him, he doesn't want to let any other people, innocent people, suffer what he suffered. And so he embarks on this quest to develop what he calls the Adam suit. And you're right, it's a little bit more Iron Man than it is our traditional understanding of Adam.
Right.
Actually, in the first while, it didn't even have a shrinking capability. It was just a power suit. But they've gotten into the shrinking capability of it now, and they're doing some interesting stuff with it.
So I feel like, you know what? I saw the teaser trailer that they put together for Legends of Tomorrow, and I know that Flash and Arrow are going to be like showing up on the team, but they're not a part of the actual series. Right. But occasionally they'll chuck them in because they're the, you know, they've
got
their
own series.
They need
to bring the audience over with them. That's why.
So, but I saw that trailer, and I know they did a bunch of reshoots and they were like fixing some certain things. I guess Vandal Savage is going to be the main big bad of the whole season. And what the idea is...
Oh, Hunter vs. Vandal Savage. That's awesome.
Yeah. It's pretty amazing that a lot of these names that, you know, from comic book fans who've been reading comics for years, you're going to get a chance to see that this person brought to life. But it's also the way they're doing it. It's almost like it's a really fun time travel thing where they're like, we have to correct the problems that he's doing throughout time. So you're going to see all these... I don't know what the series is going to be like. The little trailer was fun to see all these characters kind of interacting with each other. So definitely looking forward to, first of all, catching up on all these other superhero TV shows. God damn it. There's so many of them. And then so that I can actually have a fresh slate where I was like, totally caught up. Now let's watch this Legends of Tomorrow once every week and not have this weird burden of a landslide of like, you've got 42 hours of viewing. Like, sometimes it just feels insurmountable. It's all time management, kids. All right, let's move on. We got our minor mutations. Every week we grab a bunch of headlines and then we're just going to talk about which ones, you know, make us get sweaty. Let's go with number one. We got Batman v Superman official t-shirts revealed. False God or Gotham Demon. Number two, we got Steve Trevor picks reveal Chris Pine in 40s attire.
Maybe
40s.
Maybe
30s. Amy's
teens?
Got a theory.
I don't know. Costume history people, get at us in the comments.
Yeah,
those are putties that he's wearing.
It's
on
not
his legs.
Steampunk.
It's
that's all I know. Number three, we got Arrow. Is it possibly going to be introducing Apocalypse? Is that going to be the big bad for Arrow and let alone a lot of the other series? Are they going to slowly get this dark side situation happening? Four, we got Justice League and Wonder Woman. They're both shooting in Italy. Five, we've got Red Tornado fighting Supergirl. Will he become a regular on the show? And finally, we got Bryan Singer. Is he going to be back for more X-Men in 2017? Producing and directing? We'll find out. Let's talk about what grabs you, John.
A couple things. I have a very, very, very hard time believing that they would introduce Apocalypse and Green Arrow. Because as cool the character as Green Arrow is, a Green Arrow is not who you have as a foil for Apocalypse. You maybe get Superman and Wonder Woman and Green Lantern and all those guys all at once, not Green Arrow. So it would be, I think it would be really questionable if they did that. The other one that stands out to me, of course, is we talked about on Movie Talk earlier today, the idea that they've already planned the follow-up for X-Men Apocalypse, going to be shooting in 2017 in Montreal, where they shot X-Men First Class and X-Men, where they're shooting X-Men Apocalypse, or they did shoot X-Men Apocalypse. That's exciting to me. Remember, when Bryan Singer announced that his next movie is 20,000 Leagues Under the Sea, he also included in that tweet, don't worry guys, I'm coming back to X-Men. He didn't say when, but I think now we've got our clear indication that it's going to be that. So those are the ones that stand out to me.
Definitely. How about you, Amy?
Well, the big question with that is, like, what's coming after Apocalypse? Is it going to be another period piece? Is it still the 80s? Are we jumping into the 90s?
See, like, I don't think they're killing Apocalypse in this one. I think Apocalypse is going to be a multi-film villain. I hope, anyway. Fingers crossed.
So the second one is just full-on Age of Apocalypse? Like, he's won, he's altered the time stream, and now you have to fight your way back to...
How badass would that be? Seriously.
That follows the comics. I mean, literally. I mean,
all you need is Legion. Throw Legion in there.
Well,
we
have him now.
Yes.
Yeah, Legion is going to now be...
For some reason. Yeah. I mean, I think it's going to be great, but... It's a little odd.
I don't know if the TV series will tie in necessarily.
I don't know.
It's hard to tell.
Is
Fox going to do a shared universe with their TVs and movies? So, I personally hope that whatever the new trilogy that Bryan Singer is going to embark on is sort of like a X-Men Redux, where it's got Cyclops and Iceman and Jean Grey, but it's also got Jubilee. It's like a mixture of what's old and new, because that's kind of what X-Men Apocalypse is doing. Like once Days of Future Past kind of forced the weird, strange X-Men world
into this bizarre time bubble and then spit it back out. Like, all the bad things that sucked in these other X-Men movies didn't really happen. We're in a brand new world. Got to watch the new one to find out how, what, you know.
Well, they kind of did that with Days of Future Past.
Right, that's what I'm saying. Yeah. The Days of Future Past kind of did the reset where Wolverine is back at the Charles Xavier's school and there's Jean Grey. And you're like, oh my God. So that was modern day. So what I think is happening is that's the new world, the world that we live in technically now. What are we going to go with Bryan Singer's? We're doing the 80s because they did the 60s, then the 70s, and now we're in the 80s. What is this one going to be? Is this one going to be 90s? And if it is 90s, then it's apocalypse. And then it makes total sense that it's this weird futuristic world that, you know.
But two movies of apocalypse, you think they'll do it?
I think, see, the reason why I think they could is because, I mean, Apocalypse is, he's the apex predator. I mean, right? Like, he's the top of the food chain. And I think you have a missed opportunity if you don't leverage that for multiple movies. I think you use him for multiple movies. I mean, they were very smart to make sure that X-Men 1 wasn't X-Men versus Magneto and kill Magneto at the end.
Right.
You use that. You stretch
Magneto's
out.
In every single X-Men, as he should be.
That's true. It doesn't weird me out that Magneto's in every movie. Yeah.
So pivotal of a role, too. Yeah. So I think there's a lot you could do with Apocalypse, and I think they keep him around. I don't think they end him. So I could be really wrong.
I mean, granted, he's also really hard to kill. So.
He's very hard to kill.
I think that's a smart call. I like the picture of Chris Pine as we don't know which Roger Trevor he's going to be. Like, is he going to be Steve Trevor in the past and then somehow gets into a time portal and gets into the future?
And someone had to remind me that they did this, but in the original like Wonder Woman TV show, Steve Trevor and Steve Trevor Jr.,
well, I think that's what they're going to do. They're kind of rocking this thing where it's like, this is the grandfather of Steve Trevor and Wonder Woman, Princess Diana, then sees a dude who looks exactly like the person that she was in love with. So I don't know if they're going to do that or not. I wonder about that. It's definitely, I mean, it could work. We'll see how it works. But and I'm going to get one of those Gotham demon T-shirts, the Batman, the Gotham's demon.
I want that shirt.
I'm getting that shirt. And John Campea stars once again in Supergirl as Red Tornado. It looks just like...
When I saw the picture of that dude, somebody sent it to me, said, are you Red Tornado in Supergirl? I'm like, what are you talking about? And then I saw a picture, I'm like, yeah, that really does look like me. I can't deny it. That looked a lot like me.
I like Red Tornado. I know he's like an android. He's a cyborg. The costume, the way it looks in the photo is a little cheesy, but I'm sure they'll, you know, when you actually see it, it's shot better. Costumes always look that way. They're like, that's a behind-the-scenes set photo. That's not exactly how they're going to be shooting it. So, you know, I think Red Tornado will end up being an ally to Supergirl, is my guess, that he'll be returning. He's not a villain. He's almost like the Vision, you know?
That's the kind of character.
And then, they were definitely visioning him up a little bit, you know? They're like, oh, I see let's bring him into Supergirl. That's our Vision. So,
what's the thing is for it? It's our Infinity Plus Stone.
Yeah, that's
it's
right.
Not an Infinity Stone. Yeah. It's an Infinity Plus Stone.
Yeah, get it right. Plus Stone. All right, this week we got on Flashback. Is Men in Black. 1997, ladies and gentlemen. We got Tommy Lee Jones and Will Smith starring in the adaptation of a little-known comic book property called Men in Black, published in 1990 by Lowell Cunningham. The movie version, MIB, Men in Black, was the smash hit that we all wanted to see. It was a lot of fun. It was basically like took a lot of these weird stories that we'd always heard about, like, when you get abducted, these dudes show up and neutralize you. Well, this comic book had J&K, two agents, who investigate galaxy-wide threats, and they would like neuralize the memories of all the witnesses to keep everything secret, and you're introduced to this whole weird secret world through Will Smith's perspective as Tommy Lee Jones brings him in to be the new agent that he needs. What are your guys' favorite memories of Men in Black? We'll start with you, Amy.
The little spoilers for Men in Black? Is mm-hmm. that a thing? I don't know if I should be careful with that.
It's 1997. Anyone who has not seen Men in Black,
You've had your chance.
Yeah, if you haven't seen it, I'm just going to do this. And then when we're done talking about Men in Black, I'll do that again. So if you haven't seen it, get on it and please see it. It's amazing. All right, here we go.
It's just definitely like the fun of the thing. But the image that always comes back is like the cute little dog with the universe around its neck.
Oh, yes.
Like,
totally.
That's my favorite bit.
It was Will Smith doing Will Smith in a movie of Will Smith doing Will Smith. Was really called for.
Nice.
And it worked. And Tommy Lee Jones was great. But I'm sorry, the thing that really is, I haven't recovered from this. You were reading off the story and you said the 1997. I was just like, wait, what? That thing's like turning 20 next year?
Yep.
That's Oh, damn.
Get ready for our segment, you know, Rewind, yeah, Rewind Feeling Old.
Watch for Rewind in 9 months. 9 months of Rewind will be featuring Men in Black, and I can't believe
that. I think it was a fantastically well-made film. It was a really fun adventure. It was something that refreshing and new, and it really surprised a lot of people, and me included. I was like, what's it going to be like? I didn't realize how action-packed it was going to be. I mean, Men in Black 2 wasn't as good. It fell off, and let's not even talk about Men in Black 3, but the first Men in Black, I mean, when you get something that well-made, just from fun from start to finish. It had the weird, creepy, strange alien. It had all the different aliens always hiding in disguise. I mean,
oh, and the shooting test. I forgot that's the other favorite part.
That was
like
a great
how
part.
He gets in by like ignoring all of these aliens. He's like, that guy's just working out. That guy's just trying to buy groceries. But that 6-year-old with the trig textbook shoots her in the head.
Bam! Fantastic film. So, all right. End of spoilers. All right, watch Men in Black. And now I've got the neutralizer. You will remember nothing. All right, we've got Spotlight this week. And this week we are going to highlight an incredible comic book that I think would be fantastic as either a television series or a movie. It's called Astro City. Astro City is created by Kurt Busiek, Brent Anderson, and Alex Ross. Now, this is a world, it's basically the city called Astro City, and the whole world's filled with heroes and villains, many of which magnify or imitate other more famous Marvel or DC characters. But the major essence of the story is to get behind the masks, and you see what the characters, what's really behind their inner thought processes, them waking up, what do they have for breakfast, why do they do crimes, why do they fight evil. It's a really cool way of telling stories that sometimes you're a little bound up when you're dealing with like Batman or Captain America, because not only you have an overall 1 year kind of story arc that you meet with all the main editors and chiefs of all these magazines. And they're like, look, this year we're doing Infinity STEM, you know, whatever it's going to be. We're growing STEM. Inside of a tiny tree, and at the end we explode. You can't do anything. You can't do this. You can't do that. You have to have this. You have to have that. So they all kind of have this story arc, and they're also bound by certain things, like, you know, Captain America can't just one day like wake up and like, I'm going to kill people. You're like, no, Captain America would never do that. Well, if you have some other weirder character as like, you know, stress disorder or something, and they're like, the writer's like, look, I want to talk about like why people snap, and I want to create a character who snaps and then gets better and finds out about that, but I can't do that with Captain America. I could tell that story with someone else who's like Captain America. And also, so it's when you create these like ancillary amalgam characters, it allows you to tell all these different kind of stories. If you're into that, you will love Astro City. Kurt Busiek, who had an incredible run on the Avengers about 10 years ago, fantastic writer. He really, really did a really good job taking all these different elements from all these different characters. I wrote down, like, he pinpointed what we love about all the iconic characters. He remolded them into a newly synthesized kind of rebranding of all these archetypes. You have Superman's, you know, Superman-esque Samaritan. You have the Fantastic Four type First Family. You have the Honor Guard, which is basically Captain America. The Honor Guard, which is Justice League, but it's, or Avengers, led by Silver Agent, who's Captain America. Mm-hmm. You got a dude who looks like straight out, basically Robert Mitchum with metal. He looks like Colossus, but he's an old dude, and he just got out of prison. So that's one of my favorite comic book stories. Is like this dude who's like just made of metal. He's like an old sad sack old dude. He's like becomes a fry cook or something. Remember, it's like what do you do when you're like a bad guy and you've served all your time in jail? Like, you're free to go, dude. There you go. Here's enough money to go get sneakers. Now get out of here. You know, it's fantastic. I highly recommend checking out the comic book series Astro City. Let's talk about it. I think it'd be great as a TV series or as a series of movies. John, have you been able to check out Astro City?
Well, I mean, first of all, if you're looking at this cover of it and you're thinking, why does that look like a ripoff of Kingdom Come? Well, there's a reason for that, because it's the same artist. Yes. It's Alex Ross. Yeah. He did them both. Here's what I really like about this. And there's a lot of these Spotlight segments where I think, no, that would not make a good movie, and that would not. This is interesting. And the reason this is interesting to me, particularly if you wanted to explore on like an Amazon or a Hulu or a Netflix series, is that it frees you. You can tell these superhero stories, kind of what they were going for in the comic itself. You can tell a lot of these stories that you just couldn't if you were within the established DC universe, even the television universe, or if you were in the Marvel Cinematic Universe. There's just so much you cannot do. You can explore all those stories you always wish you could tell about Superman or Batman or The Flash or whoever, in here, and there's no consequences to it because it's not tied to any grander television universe. It's not tied to any grander movie universe. Mm-hmm. You don't have to worry about confusing audiences or anything. It literally gives you a writer's playground and a creator's playground to come up with these stories that you've always wanted to see, but for practical reasons never could. And on that basis alone, this is something that I think could work.
Mm-hmm. How about you, Amy?
So when I saw that this was the spotlight thing, this has been on my need to read list forever. I went on like a tiny mini binge on Comixology where I found like a bunch of the number ones. And the thing that really blew me away was the perspective of it. I think that it's great that you can use these sort of like off-brand versions of major heroes. But the thing that really stuck with me in the couple of them that I had a chance to read, like the first issue of Local Heroes, it's all about the doorman at a hotel in Astro City. And it's this incredible short story about this guy and why he came to Astro City and why he would choose to stay and how he sees everyone around him react to heroes and heroism. And like, all these people come in and out and they're there one day in the big city. They take various, like some people love it and some people hate it. And it was just amazing. And if you could replicate, if you could bring that sort of sense of point of view to whatever you did, I think like a TV series would be a great place to do that. And I mean, there's no reason you couldn't do a TV series in an occasional movie. Like this is the kind of universe that would accommodate that.
And I think the storytelling technique, now correct me if I'm wrong, isn't Kurt Busiek, didn't he do Marvels? Didn't he write Marvels or is that Mark Waid?
Oh God.
If one of you guys want to check for me, let me know if like who wrote Marvels, was it Kurt Busiek or Mark Waid? But anyway, it's the perspective is what's the most interesting thing. Is like you're saying, it's a smaller perspective. So even if it is a Superman character, it's like from his perspective. So it makes it you could turn this into a television series without blowing the piggy bank by having minimizing the scale. Even though it's about, you know, the Fantastic Four, you've got the first family, but they minimize the scale. So even though there are all these fantastical things happening, they tell it from a more human side. They humanize all these superhero characters. So who is it? It is Kurt Busiek. Good. Because it's like, basically, I was thinking, like, yeah, because what was the origin of Astro City? It was Marvels. Because Marvels was telling, oh my God, all this incredible stuff is happening from the street person's perspective. Mm-hmm. It was from that one newsman, a reporter who was taking the pictures. I think he was even reporting to J. Jonah Jameson. He was like,
I think so.
Jameson's like, get me more pictures of Galactus or whatever. That's another one. If you've never checked out Marvels, not only did it introduce all of us to the incredible, amazing, talented master, Alex Ross, who's not only an incredible painter and brought some of our most amazing covers and Kingdom Come, Marvels, the list is endless, incredible talented artist. He's also the designer of most of the characters for Astro City, him and the incredible interior artist, Brent Anderson. That team of those guys have just been just incredible. So definitely check out Marvels as well as Astro City. So that's it for us. Let's move right on to our Twitter questions this week, starting out with Oszilla. I believe you're probably a giant lizard that lives in Australia somewhere, perhaps in the Sydney waters. Oszilla asks, which comic would you like to see adapted to an animated film? John, what about you? What would work as an anime?
Well, I mean, I don't usually like to think about comics being converted to... I like to think about them being converted to live-action film. Mm-hmm. But this one came up on either Mailbag or Movie Talk last week, and it was on path to be developed into a live-action film, and that kind of got the rug pulled out from underneath it. But that's Runaways. Runaways is one that I think would very much work as an anime. I would still like to see the live action one. I really would. But when you look at the treatment Big Hero 6 got, and which wasn't really true to the comic, but if you took that kind of an approach to Runaways, you could do something pretty cool and special with it. So that's one that I would have.
How about you?
Well, shoot, now Runaways is my answer too. That's such a good idea. That would be great. And you get to have them be teenagers forever and kind of
you don't
make
have to worry
infinite
about
Runaways movies without people growing up.
They're not going to age.
I don't know. I was just thinking about more of the offbeat autobio kind of comics.
Mm-hmm.
Things like Persepolis made a great transition to an animated movie. So folks who follow me online will already know that I'm borderline obsessed with Alison Bechdel's Fun Home.
Mm.
But I think that would make a really, really interesting animated movie just because you can replicate the elements of style and method of storytelling in a more close, less, like, you don't have to make as many changes to the vision of the story when you take something animated in that
way. I would love to see Black Hole by Charles Byrne. Now, that's a crazy, freaky story. Teenage, freaky, sex, drugs, and viruses. Done it as a horror movie. That would be fantastic. But to replicate Charles Burns' style, I would also love to see an animated version of anything that Daniel Clowes has done. Mm. I would like to see the Death Ray. I would pay good money to see Wilson. Now, I know they're doing Wilson as a live-action film, but I would like to see Daniel Clowes' his drawing style animated and brought to life. As far as a comic book property, I would rock Kingdom Come. I know they're doing, they've done The Dark Knight Returns very successfully. Jay Olivas, the director, did an incredible job taking those four issues and turning them into two separate movies, and literally didn't have to really sacrifice anything. It's I think one of the greatest adaptations of any comic book done animated, barring Mask of the Phantasm. How about you?
That one would totally work. Vaughn's Saga, where I think it would be one that would translate well to an animated thing as well. So yes, I think I'll go with Saga and Runaways.
But Saga, you'd be right back in that, like, you have to redevelop the adult animation market.
I know. Just embrace it. There's a lot of filthy stuff.
No rating. Don't even release it with a rating.
Just bring on the filthy with that.
Bring it on. The filthy. Echoing John Campea there. All right, next question. We've got Adil of Steel asking, hey, John, love the show. Thank you. Do you think Superman will have a stronger character arc in BVS, Batman vs. Superman, compared to MOS Man of Steel? John, as a giant fan of Man of Steel and seeing all of the trailers so far and hearing everything that you've heard for Batman v. Superman, what are your feelings about the character of Superman and his story arc carrying on from Man of Steel, and how big of a part will it play in this Batman v. Superman?
Yeah, by definition, it's going to be smaller because now he's got to share the screen with Batman. And we got to get Batman introduced. This is the new Batman. We got to get him introduced to the cinematic universe. Right. I thought, once again, I know I'm in the minority, and that's fine. I thought Man of Steel was brilliant. Nothing short of brilliant. I every time I watch it, I find more that I appreciate about it. I like it more and more. I love the character arc in it. And I think Batman vs. Superman is going to be amazing. I'm thrilled with everything I'm seeing so far. But as far as Superman himself goes, but like I said, by definition, it's now not just Superman, it's Batman vs. Superman. Superman's had his introduction. He's been established in the universe now. You want to carry on that development, but you got to pay a good amount of attention over to Bruce. And that's why I believe we heard Zack Snyder say, look, in the first half of the movie, it's more Bruce Wayne and Batman heavy than it is Man of Steel by necessity. And I think that's the way they got to do it. So I think you're going to see a little bit less than you did in Man of Steel.
How about you, Amy?
I don't really have a guess on this one. That sounds incredibly logical to me, but... big nerd shame. I've been backburnering Man of Steel since it came out.
Right.
Still haven't quite sat down.
I think you'll be pleasantly surprised. I also really enjoyed Man of Steel, and I think it's one of the better Superman movies that have come out in the last 20 years. Let's just put it like real simply. I can't really even count Superman 4, Quest for Peace, as a film. It's more of an experiment in terror if you end up watching that film. Torture your friends and make them see that film. Man of Steel is a fantastic movie, and it moves the Superman mythology into the present day. And I think the story arc, even though we might not see that much of Clark Kent and Superman in that first hour, the presence of his story arc having... the destruction of Metropolis be so heavily tied into bringing Batman back or bringing him into the story.
Yeah.
Therein, just alone, the story arc is anchored by the story of Superman. So that Superman doesn't have to be in every scene. He is a presence within every scene. So I feel almost that it's a continued story arc from Man of Steel. Here's a middle piece, which will introduce all these other characters. And then whenever we get Man of Steel 2, that'll be a Superman-focused film, but this film will also be Superman-heavy just in the presence of there's an alien that floats around and look what it did to our city. All the other heroes of the planet, good or bad, will have to...
Yeah, Superman will be the impetus for everything that happens in Batman vs. Superman.
He is the anchor point. So moving on, we've got Eduardo Morales asks, if you had to choose one graphic novel to be brought to the big screen, what would you choose? So one graphic novel. Well, we talked about what we wanted to do animated. Now let's talk about live action. That's what I'm looking at. One graphic novel. You know, I mentioned Kingdom Come. That would be really hard to do live action. I mean, that's one of those things that if that was in DC's playbook where they're like, we're bringing everybody together. We're going to end everything.
There's a lot of fences you got to jump to do that one. Well, I mean, a couple, 3 years ago, I would say Dark Knight Returns, obviously, but they've done that animated. Mm-hmm. Big screen would be fascinating. Big screen live action would be fascinating. They've already done, I mean, one of the other big ones that geeks for a long time have always wanted, and that's The Watchmen. Right. So that's already done.
Arkham Asylum is kind of being done in Suicide Squad, it feels like. It feels very Suicide Squad-y. Like Arkham Asylum, if you go back to Grant Morrison's original, and it's beautifully painted by Dave McKean, but if you look at it, it's like, yeah, it's not as like psychological, like well, who's the guy Arkham and all the backstory, but it kind of is like touching on a lot of the villains that are in Suicide Squad, and it's all kind of centering around this prison, you know?
Can I count a Calvin and Hobbes collection as a graphic novel?
Of course.
Because, okay, Calvin and Hobbes then.
Oh, really?
Calvin and Hobbes. Oh, I'd love to see a live action Calvin and Hobbes. I would totally adore it. It would probably be a mess. There's no way you can match it in live action the spirit of it. But I'd like to see them take a crack at it.
What if it turned out like Garfield? You're like, no.
Oh, no. Well, yeah, I mean, that's always a possibility.
Anything
but
for you?
A lot of the answers I would have given a couple years ago are now rightfully getting the TV treatment instead.
Yeah.
Like, because, you know, back in the day, we just sort of assumed if you wanted them to do it right, you needed to propose it being a movie. So I would have said Preacher and Why.
Right.
Or Transmet. Or totally. A lot of these things. But now it's like, well, no, they belong in long form serialized storytelling.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I'm not sure what I want
to
see.
I'm
going
to go back to the Dan Clowes pull list and say like a velvet glove cast in iron. That would be like Blue Velvet. That would be the most effed up movie you could possibly watch. It would mess you up. You'd be sitting while the credits were rolling, but like, what did I just watch? Because that's how I felt when I read that comic book, and it's fantastic. So I'd say like a velvet glove cast in iron, go get that comic right now and trip your brain up. Let's move on. We got the next question is Robert Johnson. Will the success failure of Jessica Jones and Supergirl have any effect on female-led superhero movies? So the success or failure of either Jessica Jones, the success right now of Supergirl, let's lead you off, Amy. What do you think?
Well, we were talking about this a bit earlier, and it's any negative effect they could have would be fundamentally irrational, because for some reason people insist that doing something badly and that thing not working means it should not be tried again, and that's just dumb and has always been dumb. Mm-hmm. But I certainly hope for a positive effect. And what I especially love is about the combination of Supergirl and Jessica Jones, especially if they both work and if they find audiences right now, it's such a wonderful proof that there are different kinds of stories that can be told and that it applies just as much to women as it does to men. And that's glorious. I could not be more excited that both of these things are happening right now. So I hope that it has a positive effect just in terms of making people sort of go, oh, you can do that? You can tell that kind of story?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's my hope.
How about you, John?
I think individually, I completely agree with Amy. I mean, as like Supergirl, it's success or failure. You can't really pin that on a judgment or a result of a female-led super. It's one thing. Maybe the show was bad. Maybe the show just didn't appeal. Maybe the story was weak. Maybe for whatever, there could be 1,000 elements. Now, what I'll say, though, is Supergirl and Jessica Jones combined that are completely different characters, right. Completely different series. You're going to have completely different tones and all that kind of stuff. I would say that combined as a sample, a little bit bigger of a sample size, let's say they both do really well. That Supergirl does really well and it's very light, even though it's on CBS, it's very CW-ish,
yeah.
All that kind of stuff. Jessica Jones, based borderline R, like harder, all that kind of stuff, and they both do well, then I think like a studio person can sit back and go, there is an audience for female-led stuff.
Yeah, pull the plug, go ahead, give green light Queen and Country right now. Like, yeah, do it. No, push all this stuff that's been sitting around in development for ages. Like, maybe they'll get brave.
Right. Yeah, wasn't from Inception, Juno, who was supposed to be in
Ellen Page?
Ellen Page. Yeah, she was attached to that for a long time.
For a long time.
Then that got pulled. But consequently as well, if Supergirl fails and Jessica Jones fails, then I think that could affect it negatively, unfortunately, fairly or not fairly. So far, the start for Supergirl's been good. the anticipation for Jessica Jones is great.
It's off the chart for me.
Now we got Wonder Woman coming. We got Captain Marvel coming. Yeah. I mean, the next 3 or 4 years, I think, are going to tell us a lot. And I think it's just a very bright future for this sort of stuff.
And you've got a lot of really great female characters that are coming in all these other movies. Obviously, you have Black Widow. You have possibly Hela. You've got a lot of these different characters who are in Suicide Squad. You've got Harley Quinn. A lot of strong female-led characters who are part of a group movie, which are all these superhero films. I think it's going to be a good year for ladies and men next year. That's what it's looking like. Next question, we've got Jack Bowen asks, "Hey John, love the show. If you could pick any Spider-Man villain for the next standalone, who would you choose?" Now, I've thought long and hard about this. It took me about 33 seconds. I choose Mysterio. Now, I wanted to see Mysterio for years, and I want to see the fishbowl-headed weird dude with the cape, the Steve Ditko Mysterio. I don't want some brand new version of him. I don't need to see it because he's a special effects artist who's messing with Spider-Man. That's who he is. That's how he causes crimes. That's what I want to see. He's not a big villain, but I'd like to see that character done the right way, just because as a kid, I always loved the look of that character. You grow up and he's like, why is he wearing a fishbowl? It's like, relax. It's just a weird look. What do you think, John? What's your character?
I think I want to know why he's wearing a fishbowl. Kraven the Hunter. Yes. I want Kraven the Hunter. There's a lot you could do with a dude like that, especially now with a rebooted Spider-Man. It's like, hey, we're got out. Like, it's still relatively fresh. Even though they're going to say Spider-Man's already been doing his thing,
right. He's
very, very young, and so he's only been doing for a while. Kraven the Hunter picks up on this, searching for that next big... I think Kraven the Hunter could be very cool.
Very good.
And I think he would fit in well to the wider Marvel Cinematic Universe now that these characters can jump back and forth between the Spider-Man standalone universe and the Marvel Cinematic Universe. I think he's a good fit for that overall picture, too.
Definitely. How about you, Amy? Your villain of the Spider-Man universe.
Well, it's funny because I was going to say Black Cat, although she obviously would need to... I would want her to take a hero turn and they would unite against whoever hired her to do whatever by the end of the movie. But now that I think about the fact that this will be our first look at the new Spidey, I don't know. Someone more classic could be fun. Like a really interesting, very sympathetic Vulture story. Mm. Like, I know that's not going to get a lot of butts in seats, but like, I think that would be really interesting. Just the youngest person and the sort of like that Spider-Man is essentially about the most human stories with the weirdest bad guys.
Right.
I think that would be really cool.
I would love to see that team up. Like originally Raimi was trying to get Vulture and Sandman. I would rock Vulture and Scorpion.
Ah,
the Scorpion and make
be cool.
Vulture, because the Vulture is like makes his own flying apparatus, but he gets another like, you're gonna be the strength, I'm the air and sea or air and land, whatever. Just get the Scorpion in there, because I always liked that he was like this weird criminal and he puts on this bizarre green outfit. Why does he have a stinger? Well, that's why he's the Scorpion,
exactly.
I mean, the Spider-Man rogues gallery are very like, they're really, you break it down, they're pretty fun, they're pretty simple. It's like Batman and Spider-Man have the best super villains. They have enough. You have like a nice like list. You can list about 12 right off the top. You're like, bam, you got a bunch of them.
And then
it's
you get
a lot
to like
harder.
The tarantula and big wheel, and it's bad time.
Oh, Jar Jar Binks.
Jar Jar. Oh, God.
Misa kill Spider-Man.
Misa want to kill myself now. All right, next one. We got Brenton Kelly asks, should DC and Marvel have A-plus artists like Jim Lee, Jason Fabok, and Dust005, who I don't know who that is, and Alex Ross, paint beautiful movie posters? What he's basically saying is, let's get those guys who do the incredible monthly blow-your-mind comic book covers to get into the movie business where we just see a giant photo of somebody's head.
I miss art covers. We already have like Francesco Francavilla doing amazing throwback covers to things for Mondo and other places. Like, they're already doing it. Hire them to do it.
Yes.
I think that's a...
Dustin Nguyen, by the way.
Dustin Nguyen.
Oh, okay. That would be wonderful.
What do you think, John?
No.
No?
It's just a matter, again, of something I go back to a lot. Different mediums call for different things. And like, what is great and awesome and wonderful and awe-inspiring on a comic book cover may not have the same appeal to a wide non-comic book reading audience on a movie poster that needs to have mass market demographic appeal. And so for that reason, I say, you know what? Keep their work where it is appreciated and where it is loved and where it is treasured, rather than just trying to commercialize it, throw it on the big movie posters where it's not going to be appreciated the way it is right now. So I would personally say no.
I would say yes for the simple reason I find most movie posters boring and bland. At this point, I don't see any creativity put into it. It's a marketing team of a bunch of 20-year-olds who barely know Photoshop, and there's some dude just slap that guy's face on it. Nothing appeals to me less than movie posters at this point. Occasionally, we get Star Wars: The Force Awakens, where we get somebody put some time into that poster and designed.
Remember,
it.
It's not about appealing, making a poster that makes you and me think, oh, that looks good. It's about what type of a poster, and they've done so much research on this over decades. If another person walking down the hall in the theater going to their particular theater, which posters are going to catch their eye? What design styles catch their eye and gets their attention, but and that's what it's all about.
There was
them.
A time when there art was. On the posters worked. Why would that change, and how can you educate audiences back into the Bob Peake era of gorgeous movie posters?
Thank you for mentioning Bob Peake. He's one of the greatest, as well as Struzan. There was these artists who worked in the commercial world, and then they would get hired to, here, design this, here's some elements. And they kind of put it all together, and I think that art has been lost. And I'm a big proponent of bringing that art back. The comic book idea might not work, but it's less about comic books and more about bringing an actual, what is the essence of the film, and can you get that, can you distill it into the movie poster?
Oh, those are my favorite posters. We talk about it on the movie talk all the time. Is my favorite poster is the one when you look at the poster and you feel like in a single frame they have captured the spirit of what this movie is going to be. There was an interesting study done back in the when Blockbuster was still a real thing.
Right.
Because you remember there was a time when the DVDs and VHS tapes, even when they came out on home video, they would be in Blockbuster and whatnot, and the cover was the movie cover. Yes. It was the movie poster. And then something strange happened. Suddenly, the covers on the DVDs were no longer the same covers, or no longer the same as the movie posters. What happened? What they did was they did this little study about different styles that would get people's attention more. And so what they did was they got, let's just say, call movie X. They got movie X, and they put some on the shelf that was in their normal, what was in the theatrical release poster, and then others that had this different cover on it, specifically designed to attract the attention of home video shoppers. And they found almost like 2-to-1, the ones that had the new style and design got grabbed and picked up, rented, or bought, which is perplexing because those alternate DVD covers are just awful almost across the board. And I got to feel like it's probably the same philosophy that they bring to movie posters today. But if I'm with you guys, if they could find a way to find a happy blend of what will commercially work and yet give more artistic value, mm-hmm. then that's a win for everybody.
Yeah. I mean, with comic books now we have variant covers. And there's a Mondo poster hanging over here of Man of Steel, which is a fantastic poster. That's just not the Man of Steel poster that was released to the broad billions of people. There's like, oh, there's only 1,000 of them. And the only way you see it is like going to the Mondo website. And you're like, that's kind of cool. Then you got to spend $100. So it's very niche is how a lot of these variant things are. I think a lot of like AMC will put out those posters, like even for the Spectre movie, it's just a James Bond with a skull face. So it's kind of cool that we're seeing people take chances and getting a little more artistic. I think the Star Wars Force Awakens did a really cool IMAX poster where it's just Rey standing. It's a really cool drawing.
Oh, I've heard
with the sunset
behind
her.
It's beautiful. So it's like, that's gorgeous. What I'm talking about. Like, I'm not talking specifically. The question is about getting the A-game Marvel or DC artists, but I'm bringing it into a fuller conversation about bringing actual art back to the movie theaters and to the masses. And I think that everyone who goes to see a movie deserves that. It enriches the soul instead of just seeing somebody's dumb face. Look, you're going to get to see their dumb face 60 feet across in a giant movie theater. You know what I mean?
You understand we earn our living by people watching their computer screens and seeing our dumb faces, right?
I know.
You do realize that's what we do for a living.
Slightly hypocritical. But luckily, you don't have to see my dumb face when you see it. It just says Collider Heroes, and then there's some cool snapshot of like Hela, and you're like, they're going to talk about Hela. Yeah, and then you get to watch and look at our dumb faces, talk about it for a while. But what it's really about is the ideas. So let's move on and talk about another idea. But yeah, let's get the art back into movie theater posters. So next question is Spencer Phillips asks, what are your best and worst comic book movie villains?
That's a grand question.
Let's bring it through like the last 3 years. Which characters in these superhero films really worked for you and which ones really failed? Like just in the last couple of years.
Well, I mean, the one big one that a lot of people really appreciate is Loki, obviously. Mama for me in Dread was a fantastic
great
villain.
Call. I loved fantastic. Her. I love that movie.
Yeah, and I was a big fan of, going back to my Man of Steel, I love Zod. I really did love General Zod. The new one, Terrence Stamp's original was better, yes, but yeah. I really did like the new one as well. Some of the worst, it's hard to tell what are what a worst villain was when sometimes they're good villains, they're just used in a very, very small way.
Right.
Like Marvel's made a habit out of that. Marvel's formula is we don't put much emphasis on our villains if it's not named Loki. Because we want most of the screen time, most of the attention on the heroes. And that has been a formula that's worked for them, so I'm not going to judge them for that. But it has made it so that one of the glaring weaknesses of Marvel films is that quite often their villains are not anything to write home about. Mm-hmm. Worse, though, the dark elf in the Malekith in Thor 2. I still enjoyed Thor 2, but not nearly as much as the first one. And Malekith was a misused guy.
Yeah. Wasted a great actor, Christopher Eccleston.
Oh, yeah,
wasted.
Which is a weird one. I'd
say Dr. Doom because it's the most.
Oh, God, yes.
We are almost forgetting it because it's like, are we counting that? Yes, we're counting
it. Forget it.
It was just a bad call on a lot of parts, like how they mishandled, you know, Zorijin was handled the way they were trying to like meld everybody together, but then whatever happened in those last 30 minutes, studio interference, whatever it was horrible. So I was like, I did like the walking through the hallway head exploding scene, but I was like, I don't know what movie this is anymore, you know? How about you?
You guys have named some good ones. I might have to go with the collected villains of Amazing Spider-Man 2.
Yeah, his worst.
Oh, wow.
Just sort of misused. Yeah. Like,
Paul
I think
Giamatti
there were cool
is the
versions.
Rhino?
Yeah.
You don't think he deserved an Academy Award for that?
Right, I could never make out a sentence from the screaming.
That was so bad.
Yeah,
there were things that worked in that movie, and the villains weren't exactly one of them.
Wow, you got bad Electro, bad Rhino, bad
horrible
Green Goblin, Hobgoblin, whatever you call
Goblin,
him.
But Goblin, he started out right? That's like the as Osborn.
Yeah, his performance as Osborn was great.
He was great, and then all of a sudden it's like, wait a minute, what did you just do?
He's like, I'm on a flying device. How'd you learn how to do all that? Yes. Wow.
That's
all
a good call. Yeah, that's a good
all
call.
All right, moving on. We got Fernando Sanz asks, hello from Costa Rica. My question is, what is the chance that we get a version of JLA in the WB TV universe?
Good question.
It's called Legends of Tomorrow.
Yes.
I mean, that's...
It very
that's,
much is. That's
Justice
that's,
League Future.
Yeah, I mean, that's pretty much our television version of Justice League right there. We just saw the picture of it, so that's pretty much it.
That is the answer. You're getting it, and it's called Legends of Tomorrow.
But
check
it out. But I
guess
they'll probably avoid that name branding thing.
Yeah, for sure.
Like,
they're
going to
keep like their characters kind of separate, I think. All right, the next question is... from Brenton Kelly, and he asks, could you see Grant Morrison's Claws being made into a live-action movie? So Grant Morrison just came out with a pretty fantastic origin comic book about Santa Claus.
I haven't read it yet. It's really good.
Amazing. I mean, he got a really great artist, and it's really fun.
That's awesome.
And so I would pay money to see this movie, Claws. If they were like next year, they're like, yeah, we're making it. We're going to rock it out in 1 year, and it's coming out next year. I'd be like, I am paying money to see
that
movie.
You know what that will totally depend on now, though? There's a little movie coming out right now called Krampus. If Krampus can make coin, and I don't mean $150 million.
Right.
If Krampus can leave theaters having made like $50 million when it's all said and done, then something like this becomes a very viable possibility. Now, if Krampus comes out, does $12 million total, then it's probably going to smoke that idea.
Right. Well, I mean, it also depends on how they rock this. If they're going to do the Dudley Moore Santa Claus, the movie, like the Sal kinds, you're like, you guys are, who's on acid? Everybody. Like, that movie's insane.
As long as Tim Allen's in it, I'm on board.
If you've never seen Santa Claus, the movie, don't see it. Can't recommend it. All right. We're at the last question. It's called the sweaty question of the week. And that goes to Josh Carey asking, how long before we see Ghost Rider under the Marvel Studios umbrella? And would he fit in well with the existing Marvel Netflix series? So, John, what do you think? Ghost Rider, is he coming back in the small screen version?
Okay. As definitely he fits better in the small screen universe than he would in the Marvel Cinematic Universe proper. Absolutely. However, look, we say this all the time. Daredevil was made for bus fare and a bag of Doritos. I mean, that is not a large budget show. And they've done a brilliant job
with
it. You can already tell from looking at the Jessica Jones spots that these are shows that are not reliant on budget. They are reliant on great storytelling. Mm-hmm. Ghost Rider needs a little bit of a budget.
You need some chases. You need a lot of explosions.
You need all the effects. You need the violence. You need all that kind of, and I don't know if from a financial point of view, if he fits in, look, two very good friends of mine directed the last Ghost Rider movie and kind of messed that up. So I think Marvel right now is still just taking a breath. It's almost like the stink of Ghost Rider, and not just the last one, but the first one as well, right, has been so potent and so pungent that they're like, needs a little bit more time to sit, I think. I don't think you're seeing them rushing into doing Ghost Rider, but when it does, if they could solve the money issue, I kind of feel like the television side would be most comfortable. What do you think, Amy?
It does seem like if they were going to do it somewhere, the new Netflix universe would be where it would be. I saw the same budget issues seem apparent, but right. My big question is, if they do it, will it be Johnny, Danny, or the new kid, Robbie? He's been Ghost Rider since last year, and he drives a car.
Right, it's a car with flaming wheels instead of a bike.
See, I don't like that.
I don't either.
The idea doesn't go over big with anyone, but the book has actually found a lot of really dedicated fans. Like,
why,
because
though?
It's a
because
new story.
I think it's also because of the art style. Yeah. I like I got the first issue, and I was like, it's a cool like mix of anime. It's got all this different flavor. The art style is winning. Hate the car. Don't like the rest of it. I could throw it all away. But how I would bring Ghost Rider into the Netflix TV series is not make a Ghost Rider Netflix TV series. I would make a, you know, what was that one, you know, Fear of Night or whatever, just a branded supernatural.
Blade.
Yeah, where you have Blade. You'd have like a central core character, whether albeit Blade or whoever it would be.
Elsa Bloodstone. Do it.
Yeah, I would say, yeah, anybody you could carry, and then you bring all of those Werewolf by Night, you bring in Marvel's Frankenstein, you bring in Ghost Rider, you bring in Satana.
Well, now
you bring
I really want to watch this show.
See, because that's the way you do it.
You bring in Hellstrom, and we already have a Patsy Walker on
you
Jessica Jones.
Bam.
It's called, we call it the Dark Legends of Tomorrow.
Yes.
Brilliant.
DC's coming at you.
Patent that.
I know, right? Well, what did they call that one? They had a series where they brought all of them. Midnight Suns is what it was called.
Yes.
The Marvel
yes.
Midnight Suns. If they did a thing called Midnight Suns, or just call it Midnight, don't add the Suns, whatever. Just call it Midnight, and it's an amalgam of all of the Marvel darker forces.
Don't name it after a time of day, or the Twilight thing pieces will
just midnight
make you want to jump
off
a
cliff.
Yeah, Midnight
might be weird. Is it always at midnight? I give up. But anyway, that would be a good way to get all those characters in. Then you can actually spend some money on a really badass motorcycle fight chase scene, because it's only in one episode. Ghost Rider's in one episode. So, you know what I mean? Like, you could sprinkle all these cool characters all throughout.
That's true. And if you find some rad way to do it, then he gets his own series.
I know. And then everybody loves Man-Thing. They're like, he burns people who fear him. Give him his own series. Hey, guys. Guys and gals. Thank you for watching episode 33 of Collider Heroes.
Is
I'm Jon Schnepp. 33? 33. We've been rocking this for 33 weeks, yo. I'd like to thank my guest, as always, John Campea. Where can people find you online?
Hey, guys. You find me on Movie Talk Monday through Friday, on Heroes right here on Tuesdays, on Jedi Council on Thursdays, on Mailbag Saturdays and Sundays. Normally on Tuesdays on the Flash recap show, on Wednesdays on our Star Wars Rebels recap show. Lots of stuff going on. And you can follow me on Facebook and on Twitter simply at John Campea.
And where can people find your book, The Pride?
Yeah, keep your eye open for The Pride, which is coming out in December. I will let you guys know. It'll be available on Amazon and a lot of other places like that. Keep your eyes open. I'll let you know when the specific date will be.
Awesome. And our special guest, Amy, where can people find you online?
Thank you guys so much for having me.
Thank you all so much. You can find me, I'm EnthusiAmy on Twitter. You can find me Facebook, Amy Dallen. I have my own YouTube channel. I haven't been doing a lot lately, but I do vlog about comics and things. And I do every Tuesday night a live show on Twitch for Geek and Sundry, where we talk about our picks of the week and we interview comic book creators. And we have a brand new show for if you want the sillier side, called Omnibus, which is a lot of funny sort of talking head comic book discussions.
Awesome. And the first show is called The Pull, right?
The Pull, yes.
Yeah, so check her out. It's a great show.
Tuesday nights.
Yep. You guys can find me, follow me on Twitter and Instagram, just at Jon Schnepp. You can find my film, The Death of Superman Lives, What Happened, currently on Showtime Networks, or you can just get the Super 8 Hours Plus version online at www.tdoslwh.com. Get the digital super pack. Buy it for your friends while you're eating turkey this Thanksgiving.
I have three copies.
Jon Campea has
them. I have three copies.
He has three flavors. Free copies and help support independent film. You've been watching Collider Heroes episode 33. I'll be back next week with more sweat. See you then.
Hey guys, if you like this video, click the thumbs up button. Also, make sure you subscribe to our YouTube channel. It'll help you stay up to date with everything we've got going on here at Collider.